Hello, Dr. Sushma Singh this side. Today we are going to start chapter 3, Politics of Planned Development. In the last two chapters, we have studied how the leaders of independent India responded to the challenges of nation building and establishing democracy. Let us now turn to the third challenge, that is economic development, to ensure well-being of all. As in the case of the first two challenges, our leader chose a path that was different and difficult. In this case, their success was much more limited, for this challenge was tougher and more enduring. In this chapter, we study the story of political choices involved in some of the key questions of economic development, such as what were the key choices and debates about the development, which strategy was adopted by our leaders in the first two decades and why, what were the main achievements and limitations of this strategy, why was this development strategy abandoned in the later years. As the global demand for steel increases, Orissa, which has one of the largest reserves of untapped iron ore in the country, is being seen as the important investment destination. The state government hopes to cash in on this unprecedented demand for the iron ore and has signed memorandum of understanding with both international and domestic steel makers. The government believes that this would bring a necessary capital investment and provide a lot of employment opportunities. The iron ore resources, like in some of the most underdeveloped and predominantly tribal districts of the state. The tribal population fears that the setting up of industries would mean displacement from their home and livelihood. The environmentalists fear that mining and industry would pollute the environment. The central government feels that if the industry is not allowed, it would set a bad example and discourage investments in the country. Can we identify the various interests involved in this case? What are their key points of conflicts? Do we think there are any common points on which everyone can agree? Can this issue be resolved in a way which satisfies all the various interests? As we ask these questions, we would find ourselves facing yet bigger questions. What kind of development does Orissa need? Indeed, whose need can be called Orissa's need? Now let us talk. Political contestations. These questions cannot be answered by an expert. Decisions of this kind involve weighing the interest of one social group against another, present generation against future generation. In a democracy, such as major decisions should be taken or at least approved by the people themselves. It is important to take advice from the expert on mining, from environmentalist, and from economist. Yet the final decision must be a political decision taken by people's representatives who are in touch with the feelings of the people. After independence, our country had to make a series of major decisions like this. Each of these decisions could not be made independent of others' such decisions. All these decisions were bound together by a shared vision or model of economic development. Almost everyone agreed that development of India should mean both economic growth and social and economic justice. It would also agree that this matter cannot be left to businessmen, industrialists, and farmers themselves, that the government should play a key role in this. There was disagreement, however, on the kind of role that a government must play in ensuring growth with justice. Was it necessary to have a centralized institution to plan for the entire country? Should the government itself run some key industries and business? How much importance was to be attached to the needs of justice if it differed from the requirement of economic growth? Each of these questions involved contestation, which has continued ever since. Each of the decision had political consequence. Most of these issues involved political judgment and required consultations among political parties and approval of the public. That is why we need to study the process of development as a part of the history of politics in India. Now let us talk about ideas of development. Very often this contestation involves the very idea of development. The example of Orissa shows us that it is not enough to say that everyone wants development. For development has different meanings for different sections of people. Development would mean different things. For example, to an industrialist who is planning to set up a steel plant, to an urban consumer of steel, and to the Adivasis who lives in that region. Thus, any discussion on development is bound to generate contradictions, conflicts, and debates. The first decade after independence witnessed a lot of debate around this question. It was common then, as it is even now, for people to refer to the West as the standard for measuring development. Development was about becoming more modern, and modern was about becoming more like the industrialized countries of the West. This is how common people as well as the expert thought. It was believed that every country would go through the process of modernization as in the West, which involved the breakdown of traditional social structures and the rise of capitalism and liberalism. Modernization was also associated with the ideas of growth, material progress, and scientific rationality. This kind of idea of development allowed everyone to talk about the different countries as developed, developing, or underdeveloped. On the eve of independence, India had before it two models of modern development: the liberal capitalist model, as in much of the Europe and the US, and the socialist model, as in the USSR. These two ideologies, and about the Cold War between the two superpowers, there were many in India then who were deeply impressed by the Soviet model of development. These included not just the leaders of the Communist Party of the India, but also those of the Socialist Party and leaders like Nehru within the Congress. There were very few supporters of the American-style capitalist development. This reflected a broad consensus that had developed during the national movement. The nationalist leaders were clear that the economic concern of government of free India would have to be different from the narrowly defined commercial functions of the colonial government. It was clear, moreover, that the task of poverty alleviation and social and economic redistribution was being seen primarily as the responsibility of the government. These were debated among them. For some, industrialization seems to be the preferred path. For others, the development of agriculture and in particular alleviation of rural poverty was the priority. Now let us talk how planning happened in early years. Despite the various differences, there was a consensus on one point, that development could not be left to private actors, that there was the need for the government to develop a design or plan for development. In fact, the idea of planning as the process of rebuilding economy earned a good deal of public support in the 1940s and 1950s all over the world. The experience of Great Depression in Europe, the interwar reconstruction of Japan and Germany, and most of all the spectacular economic growth against heavy odds in the Soviet Union in 1930s and 1940s contributed to this consensus. Thus, the Planning Commission was not a sudden invention. In fact, it has a very interesting history. We commonly assume that private investors such as industrialists and big business entrepreneurs are averse to ideas of planning. They seek an open economy without any state control in the flow of capital. That was not what happened here. Rather, a section of the big industrialists got together in 1944 and drafted a joint proposal for setting up a planned economy in the country. It was called Bombay Plan. The Bombay Plan wanted the state to take major initiatives in industrial and other economic investments. Thus, from left to right, planning for development was the most obvious choice for the country after independence. Soon after the India became independent, the Planning Commission came into being. The Prime Minister was its chairman. It became the most influential and central machinery for deciding what path and strategy India would adopt for its development. With this, we pause our chapter here. Thanks for listening.